Take two.
It'll be all right on the night.
It'll be all right on the night. Well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
And welcome to St. James for our family service. And this morning, we're going to think about how powerful faith is, even in small amounts. But first of all, we're going to stand to sing, Morning Has Broken. Let's just have a moment of silence to bring our hearts to the Lord. Spirit of the Lord fills the world and knows our every word and deed. Let us then open ourselves to the Lord and confess our sins in penitence and faith. We confess to you our lack of care for the world you have given us. Lord, have mercy. We confess to you our selfishness in not sharing the earth's bounty fairly. Christ, have mercy. We confess to you for the times we do not trust you, Lord. Lord, have mercy. And may the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. This morning's reading is taken from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 4, verses 30 to 32, which can be found on page 1006 of our pew Bibles. It's in a section where Jesus explains to his disciples how to use parables to teach and God.
Ignore the
parable of the mustard seed. Again, he said, what shall we say the kingdom of God is like? Or what parable shall we use to describe it? It is like a mustard seed, which is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when planted, it grows and becomes the largest of all garden plants, with such big branches that the birds can perch in its shade. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Come on, you stupid pine leaves, move. I'm telling you now, for the very last time, move yourself into that dustbin by the shed and do it quickly.
huge pile of leaves.
Shh, Granddad, I'm trying to move the leaves down to the end of the garden and into that dustbin by the shed.
Good idea. I'm sure your dad will be pleased. But it may seem like a silly question. Where's your shovel?
I don't need a shovel, Granddad. I'm just telling the leaves to move. Now listen, for the very last time, I'm telling this pile of leaves, move yourselves into that big black dustbin by the shed. Now, they don't seem to want to move.
No, I can see that. How long have you been out here talking to this pile of leaves?
Well, Mum sent me out a couple of hours ago to clear them up.
I'm not sure your Mum is going to be very happy with your progress, James. So where did you get the idea of talking to piles of leaves from?
At Sunday school. This week we were talking about faith. Miss Gibbons, my teacher, told us that Jesus had said, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to a mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. So I thought I'd come and see if my faith, if I can use my faith on a mountain of leaves that needed moving. Off the lawn and into the dustbin.
I see. But I don't think Jesus wants you to exercise your faith by talking to piles of leaves.
Don't you, Granddad? Well, perhaps you'd better go up to Scotland then, where I can talk to a real mountain. I wonder which mountain I should start with. I know, where Nevis.
James, you really have got the wrong end of the stick. That is not what Jesus meant at all.
Oh, so what did he mean, Granddad?
Jesus was painting a sort of word picture, James. When he said, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to a mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. The mountain in his picture stands for a problem.
Like I'm having a bucket running to my iPad.
No, like being really unwell, or having a bad accident that leaves you with broken bones, or losing your job, or failing your exams at school, or losing your best friend, or suffering some other terrible hardship. When we are faced with these sorts of difficulties, either ourselves or in other people, Jesus encourages us to put our whole trust in Him.
Why?
Because when we put our trust in Jesus, it is like we are putting our hand into the big hand of our mighty and powerful God, who can change any situation, however difficult may be. You see, God is the best mountain mover there is.
Wow! Thanks, Granddad, for helping me understand this.
That's a pleasure, James. Now, why don't you come with me after tea to visit Mr. Scott? He has just fallen off a ladder and has broken his back. I thought we could go and pray for him. Who knows how Jesus wants to change his situation?
All right, Granddad. But please will you help me clear up this mountain of leaves before Mum tells me off for wasting time?
Of course I will, James. We'll soon get that sorted out.
A couple of hours ago before I came out here to
be an ugly little creature, and suffers much bullying and abuse. Eventually, this gets so bad that the duckling, when he's grown and matured, cannot endure life anymore. All the bullying, all the harassment, it's horrible. And he's all alone. He decides to throw himself at a flock of swans, feeling that it's better to be killed by such beautiful birds than to live life in ugliness. He's shocked when the swans welcome and accept him, only to realise by looking at his reflection in the water that he'd not been a duckling, but a swan all this time. The flock takes to the air and he spreads his wings to take flight with the rest of the new family. I'm sure we've all heard that story before. Maybe not be attempting to kill yourself by a swan, but that is the original Hans Christian Andersen version. What do you think the message of that story is, kids? What's the message of that story of the ugly duckling? Robin?
It's always
quick
people
hide,
like, quick death.
Exactly, yes. Yeah. Always treat people how you might like to treat them, so the ugly duckling shouldn't have been horrible to the ugly duckling, to the swan, in the first place. What else? Any other meaning in that, Albert? What do you think? Or maybe? Maybe it's that we shouldn't judge things by the way they look at first sight. Go on, Albert. Kindness, yeah, absolutely kindness. And maybe what at first seems bad turns out to be beautiful. I'm going to tell you another story. Four young men from a poor northern city go into a record label's offices in a big, rich city in the south. They want a record deal to be rich and famous. The record company hear their music, they like it, but not enough to sign them up. You're not good enough to be famous. No one will want to listen to your kind of music. It's just not popular anymore. Can you guess who those four young men were?
The Beatles.
Yes, the Beatles. They were John, Paul, George, and Pete.
Oh, yes.
At this point, it was Pete Best, not Ringo. He hadn't joined the band yet. And obviously, did they give up when they were turned down for a record deal? They believed in what they were supposed to be doing, and they carried on. And they went on to be the biggest, most successful rock band of all time. They didn't give up, they believed in themselves. They had faith. They had faith and they moved a mountain. The biggest record company, Decca, had just told them they were rubbish. But they had faith and they moved the mountain. I've just thought of another one actually. About 100 years ago, a gang of young men from the Northwest decided to form a football team. Everybody said, no, that football team won't get any good. And they went on to become the greatest football team this country's ever seen. Which one am I talking about? I'm going to try and be over and ask the correct answer. Well done for all thinking of the correct answer. Merseyside's best football team. I'm going to tell you one more story. A carpenter from a backwater province of a conquered country in the middle of nowhere preaches love, repentance, and forgiveness. At first, only his mother believes in him. Then he picks up one or two followers along the way, and at one point he preaches to thousands, but he can only ever really rely on a core following of a handful of people. A handful of people who have faith. Even when he dies, most of the people who originally followed him, who said they had faith, turned against him or abandoned him. Two or three people stood around him and died. But within 100 years, pockets of people who had faith, pockets of followers, had cropped up in every city in the known world. Within 300 years, even the emperor, the most powerful man on earth, was a follower. And with him, most people began to follow the carpenter. 2,000 years later, today, there are 1.5 billion this carpenter from the middle of nowhere. Who's the carpenter that I'm talking about? Kids? Albert? Who's the follower that died a long time ago and only became famous after he died? Van Gogh is a good one, that's a good answer. Yeah, yeah. A bit before Van Gogh, I think. A bit before gone. So? Jesus! Exactly, Jesus. There's something that all these stories have in common. And they all give us an insight into the parable of the mustard seed and into the wonderful puppet show we saw. Big things have small beginnings. Beautiful things may start looking pretty shabby. Amazing things look pretty boring to begin with. But God knows all and sees all. He can see the potential, the greatness in everything we do. He has faith in everything we do. He sent us the greatest kingdom the earth has ever seen, but it started with a poor carpenter's son in a forgotten part of the world. Who knows what plans he has for you, whose life may seem boring and overwhelming. He's calling you to be all you can be, to be your true self, and to change the world in some way or other, like a drop that makes ripples in a pond. So never despair, never give up, have faith, believe in yourself, and believe in God. We are all special and loved, and all of us have a calling. What is your calling? Thank you very much.
Right, everybody, I need some volunteers. Right, first of all, who has remembered the yogurt pot? You've got some. All right, I think the better way to ask this question is put your hand up if you need one. Right, children, we need to give some out because not everybody's remembered to bring them. Are these all right to go?
Yes, so long as they are. Yeah,
yeah. We'll give them to the kids. I've got a spare one here, and we've got some of those here. There's three there, and there's some of them there.
Do we need everyone?
No, it's okay.
Yeah.
Right, so if you give one to somebody who hasn't got one, then the next thing we need, I need somebody to be the volunteer to put water in everybody's pot, but only like a little bit like that, because cotton won't want to go in. So we don't want too much. So I'll have two of you, okay, of Albert and Megan. You be in charge of the water. You know what you're doing, okay? Right, you two go around. If you go and sit in your seats, because as somebody who can be... Robin, can you be cotton wool lady?
Yeah.
Right, so in everybody's pot, when they've got the water in, you need to put and dab it down, okay?
Okay.
Alright, do you want to help,
yeah.
Robin?
Yeah.
Okay.
You've got to give yourself some first, and then you go around to everybody else.
Have you got your water in there?
Not yet.
Not yet. Okay. Go and put a cotton wool in where people have got water. Things grow out of those tiny seeds.
And when they start growing, it will remind you that faith is as small as a mustard seed, and that's all that needed to make things happen. It's a good picture, isn't it? So good things come out of faith.
If these don't germinate, we know you've not been praying hard enough, so.
So we're going to sing all about God's faithfulness now to us by singing Great is Thy Faithfulness. Angela is going to lead us in our prayers.
Our prayers this morning are really informed by the stations around the church which the school children came to visit moved around talking about, it's called Experience Harvest. And so I've used the stations around church that you can see. And if you haven't seen, I do encourage you to go and have a look afterwards because they're very interesting. And so we're planting mustard seeds this morning. And like all crops, they will need water and sunlight to grow into healthy plants. So we're going to pray to God and ask Him to look after the seeds we've planted so that they turn into very small items of food. God our Father, loving Heavenly Father, thank you that you provide food for us and for people everywhere. Give us patience as we wait for these seeds to grow, just as farmers who plough the fields in spring and sow seeds have to wait until late summer to harvest their crops. Lord of the harvest, hear our prayer. Father God, we thank you that you have set us in a world abundant with produce, and you've given us the skills to grow food to support our life. Bless all who work the land and manage the countryside. May they protect the environment from damage, the earth, ocean, and rivers from pollution, and livestock from cruelty. With your justice, inspire our trading in fairness and price. God of the harvest, hear our prayer. God our Father, make us generous in our giving to those who are less fortunate than we are. Bless the work of relief agencies worldwide, feeding the hungry. And locally we ask a blessing on social supermarkets, food bank, and the Bridging the Policy Gap initiative. Risen Lord Jesus, giver of all good gifts, nurture the seeds of faith within each one of us. Open our hearts and our hands to give generously, to share generously what we receive from your bounty. Lord of the harvest, hear our prayer. Our garden group of children who look after the church flowering veg beds already know something about cultivation. And this week, they have tried their hands at weaving and knitting. And they've learned how fleeces from sheep that have been sheared are turned into wool to make blankets, carpets, and clothes to keep us warm. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for all those who make and manufacture our clothing. Lord of the harvest, hear our prayer. And over there, the children learned that some of the raw materials we use to build our houses and furnish them come from the earth. Clay has been harvested over centuries to make useful and decorative objects, like the big jars used in Jesus' day to store oil, water, and wine. And at last month's all-age service, we had a visit from a potter and watched how she used clay to shape and decorate cups, vases, and tiles. Heavenly Father, thank you for the talents and skills of craftsmen and women, and for the joy and satisfaction of creating beautiful things to use and to admire. Lord of the harvest, hear our prayer. and the fascinating creatures, great and small, that live there. We thank you for those men and women who go to sea to catch the fish we eat, a dangerous and difficult job. We remembered how Jesus called fishermen to be his disciples. And we learned how, when they were fishing, a storm arose, the weather became rough, and Jesus calmed the wind and the waves, saying, "Peace, be still." Good Lord, our Heavenly Father, steer the ship of our lives to your quiet harbour, where we can be safe from the storms of pain, trouble, and comfort and sin. God our Father, at this time we pray for all those in our church community who can't be with us this morning. And we think especially today of Mary and of Claire and Paul and their family. Be with them, we pray, and surround them with your love and care. When the sea is rough and the waves are high, Heavenly Father, give us the strength and courage to choose the right course, knowing that through enduring hardships and danger in your name, we shall find consolation and peace in your heavenly kingdom. Lord of the harvest, hear our prayer. Lord of the harvest, these mustard seeds represent your kingdom, growing within and without each one of us. Increase our faith, fill our hearts with joy, and infuse our words and our silences with your power, that we might tell others about your goodness, your peace, and your love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Our offertory hymn for this morning is "Dear Lord and Father of Mankind."
Mm-hmm.
Let us pray. Gracious God, accept these gifts and with them our lives to be used in your service through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Collect the special prayer for today for the 16th Sunday after Trinity. Lord of creation, whose glory is around and within us, open our eyes to your wonders, that we may serve you with reverence and know your peace at our life's end. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours. Now and of you, you can hold it in your hand. We're going to say this prayer together. God, we hold these seeds in our hand. We see smallness, weakness, insignificance. You see potential, growth, significance. Tiny seeds grow by your power into huge trees. They provide food for the hungry and homes for the bears. From the darkness of the earth springs forth your life, your heart. Your kingdom is like a tiny seed. When we look at your church and our own lives, we see smallness, weakness, insignificance. You see potential growth and significance. Give us eyes of faith and willing hands to see. Your kingdom grow in us. May we feed the hungry with food and the bread of life. Welcome the homeless into your family and gather the harvest you love to provide. In Christ's name and the power of the Spirit, we commit our lives to you. Let's share the grace with one another. Shall we stand for this? The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, evermore. Amen. So go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.
Thank you.